Greetings students, in this lecture we are going to discuss about the need and importance of obtaining an informed consent before providing any healthcare services. An informed consent is a document or a process for the parents to read, understand and give their signature. It explains a treatment procedure well before a patient agrees to undergo it. It also assists the parents and other family members in the decision-making process. It acts as a voluntary decision to get a specific treatment procedure. It is important to get an informed consent because it acts as a legal document that protects the medical fraternity from any medical legal issues that might arise in the future. By signing an informed consent, an individual accepts that he or she has received all the relevant information about a particular procedure or treatment option. They have understood all the information received from various professionals. Also, they have used this information in the decision-making process, whether to undergo the procedure or not. Also, they provide their consent to get some of the treatment options or all of the treatment options that has been explained to them. The key points that needs to be included in an informed consent form is similar to those of the points that has been explained to the individual or the family members during pre-implant counseling. If we include all the points that has been explained during pre-implant counseling in a consent form, the form will be too long and cumbersome. Hence, we are going to discuss about very important points that must be included in a consent form. We need to emphasize that the implants do not restore normal hearing. Though they help in improve the hearing perception, it is not going to bring back the normal hearing. Also, the auditory and speech outcomes after implantation are highly variable and unpredictable based on various factors such as the age at which the implantation was done, the duration of hearing impairment before implantation, the type of surgical procedure used, the type of implantable solution chosen, the duration of oral rehabilitation after implantation, the cognitive skills of an individual with hearing impairment, and factors like that. Also, we should make sure that the patient as well as the family members have set up realistic expectations from the implantation program through explaining the benefits and risks involved in the surgery. We should emphasize the importance of long-term oral rehabilitation after implantation and also provide the other alternative approaches that are available in rehabilitation. This is an example of a consent form which is short and crisp. Here they have explained the medical procedure that is going to be done, what are the benefits involved in this procedure, and what are the risk factors associated with this particular procedure. So, in this example, it is a cochlear implantation that is going to be done in the left ear. The benefit is it is going to improve the hearing after implantation. The risks involved in the surgery are there could be profuse bleeding during the surgery. The patient might require to wear a head bandage few days after the surgery till the surgical wounds are healed. There could be infection at the site of implantation or closer to the site of implantation. The surgical wounds may create scar in the individual with hearing impairment. During the surgery, there could be damage to the cauda tympani nerve, which will result in the altered taste perception. Also, there could be damage to the facial nerve, which could lead to facial weakness or numbness post-implantation. Immediately after implantation, the patient might feel dizzy or having tinnitus. During the surgery, there could be excessive CSF leakage, which could lead to meningitis. In the future, there could be device failure, which will warrant the replacement of the device through another surgery. Interested students can go through this link, which will open a PDF document provided by Cochlear Implant Group of India. It is a document of clinical practice guidelines for cochlear implantation. In this document, Appendix 2 has a detailed consent form for cochlear implantation program where they have included all the important points that need to be included in a consent form. The Appendix 3 has a consent form for general anesthesia usage. These are the references used for this particular lecture. Thank you.